Good evening, West Coast Barbies, New Amsterdam, and of course, right here on the Quarantine Coast. Welcome to another program of Issues in the News, where we discuss the important issues that would have taken place in our country over the last few weeks or few days or so. I believe that I owe all of you an apology, as I was not on this program for about 3 weeks, and that is because I was engaged in the parliamentary debate concerning the national budget of 2017. And as you know, parliamentary meetings begin from 10 a.m. in the morning and it lasts until 10 p.m. in the evening. So for 12 hours, we are in the parliament every single day debating the 2017 budget and considering the estimates. And then, of course, we had the important event of our Congress at Cotton Field, Essequibo Coast, the 31st Congress of the People's Progressive Party. I will speak about the Congress a little later. So those are the reasons why I was unable to be with you over the last few Tuesdays. And for that, I offer you my most profound apologies. I want to take this opportunity also to extend to you, all of you, season greetings. I know I'm a little late, but we are in the middle of the festive season, the season of love, the season of togetherness, the season of brotherhood, the season of unity, and the season that we spend quality time with our family. I want to say Merry Christmas to all of you, and I hope you enjoy this festive season and the holidays that we are in the middle of. I bring those greetings to you on my behalf, on behalf of the People's Progressive Party, and on behalf of the Leader of the Opposition, Comrade Bharat Jagdeo. And of course, I want to extend to you those festive season greetings, and to say to you that we are committed to the task at hand, and that is what I want to speak to you about tonight. But I also have with me a special guest who is visiting from New York. He is an avid follower and viewer of this program on Facebook. His name is Rohan Bechu. He is from Mara in the Burbies River, and he is here on vacation. And I will invite him now in the studio to share this program with me. Come Rohan, come.
How are you now?
I'm fine.
Good seeing you.
Yes, come. Thank
you.
Please,
have a seat. Thank you. Apologize for being late, but here we are.
Yeah. Well, Rohan is here with me, and Rohan is, as I said, is residing in New York. He hails from Mara on the Burbies River, and he is currently vacationing at Betsy Graham Kanji. So Rohan, how has your holiday been?
It's been great so far. Great so far. Thanks. Yeah. Great.
And yeah. Tell us a little about New York, the New York experience, the Guyanese experience in New York.
New York is, you know, of course, it's one of the biggest metropolitan cities in the world. It's a great place to live. Lots of Guyanese. We have over 500,000 alone, probably more, in just the one area, Richmond, yeah, and Queens.
And how do the Guyanese in New York relate to the political happenings in our country?
Oh, they're very much in tune. They're very much aware of what's going on here. They pay attention to everything, details. They're very savvy.
I understand.
Political-wise, yeah.
Every program that I post, mm-hmm, over 100,000 people.
Oh yeah.
View.
Oh, you got a big following. You're a rock star in New York.
And a lot of it, I'm told, are people from New York,
yeah,
and from metropolitan Toronto,
yes,
and Florida, etc.
We even got some fans and some people in Vancouver.
In Vancouver,
yes,
too?
Yes, sir. Yeah, okay, I got roots there, so I know.
Okay.
Yeah, they watch as well.
So, Rohan, as you know, mm-hmm, I was just telling the audience,
okay,
that we just concluded our 31st Congress,
yeah,
where a few important things happened.
Mm-hmm.
we elected a new leadership.
Okay.
And we had discussions on the General Secretary report.
Okay.
And the General Secretary report is a comprehensive analysis of what has taken place or what is taking place internationally, how it connects to Guyana nationally, and of course what is taking place in our national politics.
Right.
And then the Congress would break into workshops.
Gotcha.
Where we consider in great details the General Secretary's report.
Uh-huh.
And out of those workshops, resolutions would come, decisions would come.
Right.
Authorizing. The Congress is the highest decision-making body.
Wow.
Of the party. So the Congress authorizes the new leadership.
Mm-hmm.
To deal with a few matters. And some of the important decisions that have come out of the Congress, in fact, the singular most important decision that has come out of the Congress is for the PPP to galvanize itself together.
Yeah.
Reform itself.
Mm-hmm.
Do that which is necessary internally. Our membership has given us their fullest support.
Okay.
That once we are reformed and they are committed.
Mm-hmm.
To a singular objective, and that is to retake the reins of government so that we can redirect our country along a path of economic development and growth. It is common knowledge that we are sliding backwards.
Yep, that's
every day.
Thing, yeah.
You see that?
Yeah,
right?
Common
so,
man the street, yeah.
However, we all recognize that, let me also say that I want to extend to my colleagues, my new colleagues and the older ones who will continue to be part of the leadership, I want to extend to all of you congratulations, and I want to thank the people of Barbies, both West Coast Barbies and East Barbies, as well as the Quarantine Coast.
Right.
For taking a very large delegation. A very large delegation came from Quarantine, from New Amsterdam, and from West Coast Barbies to the Congress.
Nice.
And they give me their full support. They are all avid viewers of this program, and I want to thank them for the role that they play in making our Congress successful. Significantly, it is Barbies that traditionally returns the PPP to office.
Glad to feel that.
Region 6 and Region 5. When we lose votes in Region 6 and Region 5, we lose government.
Yeah.
That's a statistical analysis. That's the reality. And if we are to get back into government, it is Region 6 and Region 5 that will take us there. Now, I want to be very frank in my discussion tonight. And I want to say that there is no doubt in my mind that the PPP will win the next election. The only thing that can prevent us from winning the next election is that if those elections are rigged. If those elections are rigged.
Right.
We are dealing with a political party that is in government that has a history of rigging elections. They have rigged the 68 elections, the 73 elections, the 1980 elections, and the 1985 elections. In fact, I believe that they have rigged every other elections after that. But they were unable to rig it in such a way to prevent us from going into government in 92 and remaining in government thereafter until 2015. That is their modus operandi. Now that they are in government again, and now that they have the machinery of the state at their disposal, there is no doubt in my mind that they would want to rig the elections again. Therefore, I want every single Guyanese to begin the conversation of the possibility that the 2020 elections are likely to be rigged. I want that conversation to begin.
You want that
I want people to face that reality.
You feel that way, no?
I am convinced. Politics, Rohan, as you know, is about the winning of minds.
Yeah.
The winning of people's opinions.
Influencing people, yeah, of course.
Influencing people. Promulgating policies, conceiving projects.
Right.
That are designed to improve the welfare of the people.
Yes.
This government is doing none of that. In fact, almost every single policy of this government is one that militates against the welfare of the people. Every single, there is no government in the world that has imposed 200 tax measures.
Yeah, I'm surprised at that.
In one single calendar year. They passed two budgets in one calendar year in 2016.
Okay.
And they have imposed on the backs of the Guyanese people 200 tax measures and are unprepared to even consult with huge organizations that represent significant sections of the society. Not forget us in the PVP.
Right.
Let us say that we are playing politics, so they don't want to talk to us. That's okay, that's bad, but it's okay. But you reject the labor movement. The labor movement has called for a discussion both prior to the budget being read in the parliament and even after the budget being after the budget being laid in the parliament. The labor movement and the private sector commission. Now the private sector commission is comprised of over 80 organizations covering every spectrum, the entire spectrum of non-governmental activities.
Mm-hmm.
That, apart from the government, the rest of the country is the labor movement, the private sector, and the religious organizations. And two of these humongous representative organizations have requested a consultation with the government, something that this government promised to do.
Yes, of course, I follow that.
Right?
Yeah.
When they were in the opposition, they held on to an article in our constitution, Article 13, which mandates any government in charge of the state to engage in a consultative process in government as a fundamental part of the democratic equation of our country. And they have just decided not to consult with anybody on any given measure.
Shocking, yeah. That's
I attended a consultation with my predecessor, my successor, Basil Williams. And it was a public consultation. There was the private sector, there was the religious organization, there was the labor movement, and there were civil society organizations like the Bar Association. And we were consulting on an important bill. And I made 10 recommendations.
Mm-hmm.
All of them are solid. All of them received the unanimous support of every organization that was present. The Attorney General was unable to advance any sensible argument against the recommendations which I was making. Well, that I could talk another 2 hours on that. The legal draftsman, the Chief Parliamentary Counsel, was there, was prepared, once the Attorney General gave him the direction, to incorporate my recommendations in the bill that was under review. You know what the Attorney General said to those present? That this is a bill produced by cabinet and he has no authority to change it at the consultation. So I asked, so what is the purpose of this consultation? It was obviously a publicity gimmick. Immediately afterwards, I issued a statement and I said that it was an exercise in cosmetology, because it was never intended to achieve anything. So every time you in New York and you see the Attorney General holding consultations, must know that nothing will come out of it. And that was the first one that I attended, and I never went back. And organizations like the Bar Association, the Guyana Bar Association, the Guyana Human Rights Association, Amnesty International, Transparency International, have all attended. These are non-governmental, non-political organizations, and they have all attended consultations held by the government, and they have all bemoaned the fact that though they have made several recommendations and were complimented for making the recommendations, not a single one was received and accepted by the government. Not a single one.
Mind-boggling.
In 19 months. I see all of that, and I can bring in the 50% increase in their salaries and the arrogance and the multiple cases of corruption.
Right.
Look at the Durban Park project. A contractor came by me yesterday to tell me that his name was mentioned in the parliament as being owed $88 million for doing work at Durban Park. And lo and behold, the man came to tell me that he is not owed a cent, that he has not done any work at Durban Park. So, I mean, I have to make this public as soon as. So, and these guys came to the parliament with a list. And they said to us, please approve this list. These are contractors who have done work at Durban Park. And we approved the list. And they told us that it is not the full list. And there it is, a man came to me, a renowned contractor too, and said, look, I don't even have an invoice in. I don't understand. I am not owed 88, I'm not even owed 88 cents.
Is that money being funneled elsewhere, you think?
That obviously, that money is going into someone's pocket. And that is the kind of corruption that is taking place.
Where's the president in all of this?
I don't know. Nobody knows where the president is. The president speaks once a week, and that is it. You don't hear back anything from the president. I say all of that, Rohan, to make the point that this government is not in the business of winning minds and hearts. And therefore, can only expect to go back into government by rigging the elections. And hence, my theory that there is every likelihood that they would want to rig the elections. And that is why I am calling on every single Guyanese to now begin the conversation that we want changes at GCOM and prepare your minds and prepare yourselves for the event of a rigging of elections and begin to prepare yourself to take steps to prevent that from happening. We have to prevent that from happening.
You can't allow that to happen. That would be unacceptable.
That's correct. And that's the purpose of this, of me making this public.
Yeah.
It's not to accept that they will rig the election.
Yeah, gotcha.
But it is to begin to work towards preventing that from happening.
Right.
And look, if every single Guyanese, every single patriotic Guyanese, and out of, let us say, 750,000, I believe we have about over 600,000 patriotic Guyanese. And if all of us, we will defeat those, the couple thousand who are there to rig the election.
Yeah, I mean.
Right? Yeah. And that is where the diaspora has to play an important role.
Fellow New Yorkers.
In 1992, Cheli Jagan traveled the entire diaspora. He didn't travel it in 92, but he was traveling it all the time. And had organizations like the ACG, Association of Concerned Guyanese.
Very good group, I remember this. Yeah.
And different groupings of people. In Florida, in New York, in Toronto, in London. And those people did remarkable work in highlighting rigged elections in Guyana and getting international attention drawn to the issue. And I want the diaspora to begin to do that kind of work, because those who have rigged the elections and who have a history of rigging elections are back in government. And from all indication, from all evidence available, there is every likelihood that they would want to go that path. And therefore, Rohan, you have to get this momentum built in the diaspora, in all the TV programs that they have, the radio programs, if you can write in the newspapers, start to highlight this issue. So get the congressmen involved, the senators, and all those, the House of Representatives, and all those people who are so instrumental. Carter Center will have to come back here again. And that were so instrumental in having us get free and fair elections, we have to start that process all over again.
Yeah, makes sense. I'll tell you now, if I can say quickly.
Yes, go ahead.
Just for the couple of weeks I've been here.
Yes.
My feeling is like, even supporters of this government are disappointed. There's a lot of disappointment. So if an attempt to rig the election would be, it'd be chaotic, because I think everyone is shocked how what has transpired to date, starting with non-performance and then giving themselves raises.
Right.
No revenue being generated externally, but taxing the people locally. I mean, these are things that are like basic Econ 101, and they're failing.
But Rohan, these guys, they have no shame. No. They have demonstrated that in the past. They have demonstrated that in the past. And therefore, you can't put anything beyond them. For them to come in and pay themselves.
That was shocking.
I mean, and backdated to like three. They spent less than a week in office, and then paid themselves 50%. And this is a and
you have told me the president. I thought he was a man of integrity, but when he did that, he lost me completely.
And look, and Nagamutu,
oh,
a man who masquerades as a Jagannite, and who came to Barbies and told the people that he will never travel first class, and my God, the lies.
Yeah, he's there for self-aggrandizement. He's there just to look after.
Could you imagine, and that's what I'm saying, we need to do a lot more work politically.
Yeah,
could you imagine that Wales Estate, after over 200 years, 200 years or more, that estate closed its operation 3 days ago. And it just gone. 200 years of history, just gone. We did not even have a rally. We didn't even have a meeting. And I, on behalf of the PPP, accept responsibility for that. I called former President Jack Dale. Mm-hmm. I called former President Ramotar. I didn't get onto Ruhi. And I said, we have done a terrible job here to allow such a historic event to go unnoticed. It's a travesty. It is a travesty. And I understand that Rose Hall is next.
Wow.
Rose Hall is listed as the next estate to be closed.
Is that Kanji? In Kanji?
Yes, right in Kanji. Now,
that would be the end of New Amsterdam, Kanji.
That's correct. And what they think in their mind, there is a racist element in this, because they see sugar and the sugar industry as closely associated with the PPP. Yes.
That's horrible.
They see the rice industry also, but they don't know that thousands of... You see, what we have in office, Rohan, is an urban elitist grouping of people. Urban elitists. They don't come outside of Georgetown. All of them live in Georgetown, and 80% of them have been living in Georgetown for most of their life. They may have been born somewhere else, but they all are domiciled in the city of Georgetown. And all they understand, they believe that Georgetown is Guyana. They don't travel. They don't know that thousands of their supporters work. In fact, the Wales working population is almost half and half Indo-Guyanese and Afro-Guyanese. A large section of the workforce at Rose Hall is Afro-Guyanese from Stanleytown, from New Amsterdam, from that part of Barbies.
Can I add something to that? You're saying? Here's the thing. You have sugar, the estate, but the multiplier effect in economics, and you can explain that to your audience.
Yes.
It transcends to all Guyanese. It's not across, it doesn't affect the sugar workers, except affects the taxi drivers, the people in the markets, everyone, the school teachers. Everyone gets affected if the estate is closed.
You grew up here in Barbies.
Yeah, and
you
up the river,
right.
Real rural area.
And you know that next to every pay office at the estates, there is a market.
Well, lots of peripheral businesses,
There is a rum shop.
Yeah.
There is a cook shop.
Yeah.
And all of those businesses,
the car drivers, the taxi drivers,
they depend upon that pay packet of the cane cutter.
So,
right? What they don't understand also is the indirect benefits that the society gets,
that's
the community
right.
gets
yes. yeah.
from Gaisuku.
Can't
the entire drainage system at the back. The entire drainage system. Guyana, they don't seem to forget, they seem to forget
right.
that we are below sea level.
Yeah.
And the glorious network of canals that keep water off the line in the southern part of the coast
okay.
are all maintained by Gaisuku.
Yeah, the Gaisuku has a
the whole network of canals in the back there, at the back of every village.
Yeah.
And when they shut down wheels, and when they shut down an estate, they're shutting down that drainage system. Then you have, we are an agro-based economy.
Yeah.
So you have entire communities like canals number one and two that depend largely or singularly on agriculture
yeah.
to sustain themselves. Apart from the private cane farmers who sell cane to the estate,
mm-hmm.
you have the man who plants coffee, watermelon,
mm-hmm.
citrus fruits,
yes, of course,
banana, plantain, all of them come out of canal.
Right, right.
And they all depend upon a drainage system maintained by Gaisuku.
Yeah, yeah.
So when they're talking about how much it will cost to keep whales alive, what they don't understand is the cost of shutting whales down. The cost of shutting whales down is 10 times greater
yeah.
than the cost of keeping whales alive.
The human cost, yeah.
When you look at the destruction
yeah.
that will be done to that part of the
yeah,
country.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Now I know, as a practicing lawyer, in my early years of practice, I did a lot of criminal work. And that part of West Demerara plants a lot of marijuana. Right? When you close down that estate, you're laughing, but it's a very serious matter. When they close down that estate,
right.
they don't understand what they will do to the marijuana industry in that area.
Right.
Obviously,
yeah.
because people there have nothing else
so
to do.
Use or,
nothing else
and
to do.
And you don't have community support.
And that place
yeah.
supplies a lot of places in Barbies with marijuana.
Really?
Yeah. As a practicing lawyer,
well, you know,
I've been in the fields, I know.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, right?
Well, who better to know that than you?
So the domino effect of decisions that are so short-sighted as the closure of whales have devastating consequences for the country.
Right.
And when they believe that one ethnic group, it is so sad even saying that one ethnic group is being affected. They are totally miscalculated.
The taxi driver who got me here was black.
Exactly.
Yeah. He's from Kanji.
Right.
Well, you know, the locals can't afford him if they don't have income coming in.
That's
so
correct.
He suffers. Then his kids
exactly.
uniform for his kids.
And that is a classic example
yeah.
of what we are speaking
yeah.
about.
Yeah.
But getting back to that is why Rohan. We have, that is why this the 2020 elections are so crucial. And that is why we have to ensure that the elections have to be free and fair.
Can I be honest with you here, though?
Yes.
This is the first time I'm telling you. Obviously, I mean, the PPP probably made some mistakes in the past, no doubt,
yes,
right?
Yes.
And you guys have addressed that, and you're coming back as a robust party.
Yes.
You've done your internal scanning.
Yeah.
You've come up with a formula now to bring integrity into politics
yes.
going forward. Am I correct on that?
That's
what I got from you by
yes.
following you the last. I've been following you. We met. You and I met 3 years ago.
Right. Yes.
And I was taken in by your humility.
Okay.
Right? You probably don't recall.
No, I can't.
But,
you told me about it.
Yeah, we met, and you know, you showed some class. And what the thing that struck me most was your integrity. Now, a lot of PPP members approached me.
Okay.
But I wasn't too sure if I wanted to be affiliated with them then, when you guys were in power.
Okay.
So that's why I'm here. I'm here because I followed you.
Right.
And I know, and I'm sure there are lots of other guys with integrity. I just don't know them.
Yes, yes,
right?
I appreciate it.
On both sides, probably on the other side too. I don't
yes,
know these guys.
Right.
But as you meet, you form opinions. And the reason why I feel like you're getting a big following and you're bringing these people into the PPP is because of number one, the PP realized made past mistake and are moving forward in a progressive direction now.
Yes.
As a party with, like I said, the number one word here now I see is you know, the people can trust you now.
Right.
You know, you've got to, every person, whether it's black, white, brown,
say,
you know what, it's not about us now, it's about each and the poorest guy, we want to bring up his standard.
Right.
See, and that's what I want to be behind. That's the movement.
Right.
And I'll be honest with you, Anil, if Mr. Granger them could have convinced me of that, I would be sitting here now with one of them instead of with you.
Okay.
But from what I've seen,
so
I'm amazed what they've done to this point, because they waited 23 years and it's like...
Look, everybody, people have told me, called me from all over the world and said that, you know, the PPP could not have wanted a better government in place while it is in opposition. I mean, every day, you just have to wait until a minister speaks and a scandal comes out of their mouth.
Yeah, yeah.
And they are scandal prone. Can you imagine two ministers are on scholarship?
Who does the work when they're gone?
And they are being paid a double the salary that a minister used to be paid. Their scholarship is being funded. They are being paid to study. And they are still doing the government work. The thing is so wrong from so many dimensions.
Well,
and you know what? Yeah. No one knew. We got this information.
Transparency is lacking.
Right? Yeah. We got this information, perchance, by asking a question. And lo and behold, so on what basis did other Guyanese have an opportunity to compete for these scholarships? Or these people were just handpicked? And you know what was striking? And I believe that they didn't know. I believe that they didn't know. Carl Greenidge, I spoke with, and I told him, because when I received, I was one of the few who received this information. And I said, you know, you have two ministers in your cabinet who are on scholarship? He said, no, that can't be possible. And I said, yes, look, it's here. And I showed him the document given to me by Joseph Harmon. I went to Nagamutu. I went to Ramjetan. In fact, Ramjetan told me that his son wants a scholarship. And he doesn't know that scholarships are being shared in his cabinet. And they are clueless.
Left doesn't know what the right
Exactly. So you listen to these things, you experience it.
It's mind-boggling.
If someone told me this 18 months ago, I would never have believed it.
Yeah.
I would have never believed it.
No.
But you're living this. Importantly, I want to go back to the elections.
Right.
As you know, Dr. Steve Sorisbali, the current chairman of the GCOM, has resigned. And the Constitution provides that the opposition leader is required to submit a list of six names to the president, which the president finds acceptable.
Okay.
In fact, the language of the Constitution says a list of names which the president does not find unacceptable.
Right.
So there's a double negative. So you have to satisfy. The leader of the opposition submits the name, but the president must agree to it.
Okay.
It was a formula that we inherited from President Carter for the 92 elections. And then in 1995, we constitutionalized the formula. And it has been in our constitution since 1995. It survived the reform process of 1999-2001, when we did massive reforms to the constitution. And we kept it. And it is still there. So the leader of the opposition submitted the six names. Significantly, Desmond Hoyt for the PNC, Chelly Jagan first submitted the name. Chelly Jagan first used this formula, or the formula was first used in 92 when Chelly Jagan submitted the names to Hoyt.
Right.
And Hoyt made a pick from that list of six. And then we won the 92 elections. So in 1997, Sam Hinds was the president. So that list would have been submitted to Sam Hinds from Hoyt. And then out of that list came Dudnat Singh. Right?
Okay.
And Dudnat Singh was the chairman. Then in 2001, Jack Deal, I think, was the president.
Of course.
And Hyde submitted a list from which Jack Deal chose Joe Singh. And then that was the 2001 elections. And then I think Robert Corbyn submitted a list to Jack Deal again, from which Jack Deal chose Suraj Bhani.
Right.
And he did the 2006, I think, 2011 and 2015 elections. So the point I want to make is that every time the list came, so far, that this formula has been used, it was never rejected.
Right.
Every PPP president accepted the list from a PNC opposition leader. Right? Mm-hmm. And we are hoping that the same position obtains. But we will see.
Yeah.
And if, for example, the president rejects the list, then we would be, for the first time, going into uncharted sea. And we would be submitting a second list.
Right.
And that would be the first time that that mechanism went to that second stage. But it will also give an indication of how reasonable these people are in government and how prepared they are to compromise. Because, trust me, we didn't accept, we didn't like, over the years, the six names. No, you know, but it was a mechanism that was designed to achieve consensus. And in arriving at consensus, one must give and take.
Right.
So we chose the candidate that we felt most comfortable with. And of course, we have given six candidates. All are nationally known figures. All are qualified by international standards. And we are expecting and hoping that one from that list of six will be chosen.
Yeah. And we'll see. Let's give that some time.
And be made chairman of the Elections Commission. It is important that we get this process over with.
Yeah.
Because we are canvassing for reforms at GCOM to take place.
Right. So you need
we believe that we should not go to an elections unless there are certain changes at GCOM. We have already begun to review certain laws. Because, you know, elections is a statutory process. It's a legal process.
Okay.
And it has to be done. If you want to change anything, it begins with the changing of the laws. So we are reviewing that. We are also reviewing the method of voting. Do we want to continue with voting with an X and a left pencil?
Right.
Or do we want to resort?
That's crucial, probably. One of the most crucial things you may have to address.
Right.
Yeah.
Or we want to resort to a more scientific
exercise. Yeah.
Where the voter is subjected to a little more biometrics to identify him. Because we know
that imperative.
10, 15 people turn up at polling station pretending to be Rohan Beach.
Of course.
Right?
Or you can show up at different stations.
That's correct. Yeah. And because the system is not equipped to detect that you have already voted. Alright?
Yeah.
Or to identify you as Rohan Beach, as opposed to someone pretending to be Rohan Bechu,
right?
So once we have those biometric data, for example, your fingerprint or your retina scan, all of that kind of information can be put into a machine. When you go there, when you put your thumbprint, unless it corresponds with the thumbprint that is in the system of yours, then it will not generate a ballot.
Right.
All right.
Yeah, makes.
So we are looking at that, those kinds of changes, and then also Rohan. We have to change the staff at GCOM.
Oh, it's that insidious,
right?
Huh?
It is insidious.
Wow.
Unfortunately, in Guyana, people vote along ethnic lines. And therefore, you can look at someone and fairly determine which political party he is likely to vote for. And that is why the staff at GCOM must reflect Guyana.
Course.
Right now it does not. It predominates with one ethnic group. And these are important safeguards.
Yeah.
We have met with the international community.
Very
here.
Important.
We have met with the Americans, we have met with the Canadians, the British, and the European Union.
What's the feeling there?
And they have assured us that GCOM reforms are necessary. In fact, they have told us that they met with the president.
Okay.
And the president has committed to reforms at GCOM. But we can't just accept that.
Of course, you got to see
it. We need to act upon it and pursue it aggressively, because leaving it to chance, nothing will happen. All
right?
And it is in our interest, and it is in the nation's interest that we cultivate momentum in this direction.
Absolutely.
And as I said, I want you to take back a message to the diaspora about the possibility of rigging elections. And let us start that conversation. I believe that if we popularize it, then it would be difficult. If we start to have
this conversation. So this surface to the entire country, to every guy.
That's correct.
Opposition and government.
And if you bring that kind of pressure to bear on it will be difficult. Yeah. I want to take some calls now, Rohan.
Sure.
And this is an important part of the program.
Yeah,
we just missed that call though.
Go for it.
Caller in the air. Hello?
Yeah, can I speak with Mr. Pichu? His brother is on the line.
Your brother is on the line?
Not Pichu.
No, I don't have a brother in Guyana. It must be someone else.
Sorry, Mr. Pichu doesn't have a brother in Guyana.
Yeah, he don't know the man here. And not
Pichu.
Oh, yes, that's my cousin, of course. Yes. Hi, how are you?
Yeah, how are you? It's good to see you.
Yeah, nice seeing you. Hey, we're just here.
You see?
Take my phone number.
Could you say it aloud?
644. 4492.
4492?
Got it. 644-4492. Got it.
Yes.
Okay, now. Hello. Thank you.
You hear your program is fantastic. I have listened to you many times. And I do hope you guys get through. But you guys must realize that this Mr. Granger is Madam. He deals with Burnham. So you guys have a difficult task.
Yeah, I know. But we can't give up. Where are you calling from? That?
Well, I'm here in Portmorat.
Portmorat?
Yeah. Oh, 644-4492. Got it.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Rohan will call you.
Yeah. It's my cousin. Yeah.
I'll have to give you a call. Yeah.
Yes,
thank
sir.
You.
Will do.
You'll see you meet up with your family right away?
Yeah.
Caller, you're on the air.
Hello?
Hi.
Good day, Mr.
Nala. Hi, how are you? Where are you calling from?
Albion.
Yeah,
I look at some of the speeches that was made by our finance minister, and I was so shocked to hear when he said, if the rich have money, they buy chow mein and eat, and the poor must continue watch who don't have.
Yeah, I it was such an insensitive statement. A reporter called me and asked me to respond to that, and I told the reporter that I'm speechless. I mean, it is like the same thing he said about the people who are owed at Norman Park.
Yeah.
The people who are owed $750 million, he said the government will pay $500 million and the people can either take it or leave it. The government will rob them.
Oh,
I mean, I don't understand this guy.
I wanted to know why Guyanese people still sit idly and listen to all of these things about the business. People need to get up and do something.
Okay, caller. Thank you. And remember what I said about this election, the 2020 election. I want you all to start this conversation at every marketplace, every wake house, every rum shop, in the cane field, in the factory, everywhere, in the taxi, in the minibus.
Everywhere we have to take it.
All right?
Yes.
Because unless we talk about it, these people are going to rig this election.
Definitely.
And not talk, but prepare to take action to prevent it from happening.
I think one thing as a suggestion the party needs to do is to get back to the root within the villages and farm up the small...
No, we are going to do that. Oh. We are going to do that, don't worry. But we got to start first with the thought. Everything begins with a thought.
Yes, that's
all right.
Right.
And then the thought will translate into action.
Yes.
So I am in the process of implanting that thought in people's mind. All right?
Thank you
very much. Yeah, you see how knowledgeable the Barbarians are. They know everything that's going on in this country.
Yeah.
Call your ear.
Yes. Hello?
Yes.
Good evening.
Good evening. Kalyanavelli. Please, when you are on air, please be swift and be quick with your question or your point, because you know we are running out of time. Yeah, I was telling you on the phone when we spoke earlier how amazing it is that persons who, you know, are not academically qualified and so on,
right,
how they understand the subtleties and niceties of intricate political language and dilemma. Caller, you're on the air. Caller, you're on the air. You seem to have lost that caller.
Sometimes they don't, you know, sometimes
the
reception
is
bad. Yeah.
Right.
Caller, you're on the air.
Hello, good afternoon.
Please lower the volume of your television down.
Okay. Yes. I have a little problem. What should happen when you're going to last Wednesday? I shouldn't have been young for that hospital, right?
Uh-huh.
And they have no injection. If my brother didn't give him the family back, they wouldn't tell me anything. You have to buy the injection. I don't know what happened here for that hospital.
Where are you calling me from?
Port Barad, right?
Port Barad?
Yeah, Port Barad.
And what type of injection? You don't know?
Rosafin.
Rosafin?
Yes.
Okay. You know, every time we raise this thing in Parliament,
yes,
you must look at the TV.
I got to show.
Right. And you will hear Dr. Frank Anthony, Dr. Barry Ramsaran, and Dr. Vishwa Mahadeo, and sometimes Dr. Vindhya Prasad. We have five doctors on our side. Oh, and that's four. Six. And when we raise these things about drug shortages, these people deny. They say that these things don't happen.
And these things are not in life too. They are not good. They don't treat my mother good at all. That is my mother. The entire people at the entrance are not too.
All right, caller. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I want to make a few announcements. Let me take this call. Caller, you're on the air.
Hi,
hi, where are you calling from?
This is Blackbush.
Blackbush?
Yes.
How is Blackbush?
Very, very.
My Mercury?
Yes.
Okay, what going on? They don't have drugs at My Mercury Hospital either? All right, look. So there is no pharmacist or dispenser that is at Blackbush permanently?
No, they got to go for answers in Amsterdam.
All right, look, I know that the regional chairman, the vice chairman, Dr. Vishwa Mahadeo, member of parliament, and Anamaya, member of parliament, are watching this program. And Zulfikar Mustafa as well, the former regional chairman and member of parliament. I know that they are all watching this program. So they are taking notes of what you're saying. All right? All right, I'll bring them on back on the program. I know. Well, I know. I had to speak about it. I think it's deliberate. All right, caller. Thank you. Again, you see what the caller is saying? Whenever my program is on, they give Blackbush blackout. Because they know the whole of Blackbush watches this program, right? And also the lower quarantine.
That's very crap.
Right? And I had to appeal to GPL because it's a routine. Yeah. Caller, you're on the air.
Yeah, Maya.
Yes, Maya. What which village are you calling me from? Hello? I'm sorry, I lost that caller. I wanted to make a few announcements as we wind down in this program. I am told that the police officers at Reliance, Kanji, again are beginning to impound people's animals wrongfully, and they are charging illegally $5,000 to release these animals. $5,000 they are charging, and they are not issuing any receipts. Obviously, that means that they are pocketing that money. I am calling on Commander Watts my good friend, please look into the conduct of the officers at Reliance Police Station. They were doing this before, I spoke about it, and they had stopped. Now they have resumed. They are improperly and unlawfully impounding people's animals, and they are charging $5,000 for the release of those animals, and they are not giving a receipt. Therefore, they are taking that money. I am assuming that publicly, because why else would you not want to give a receipt? That's the first complaint. The second complaint is that I am told that I'm calling on GPL to look into this matter. Apparently, all the houses in the compound of the station are drawing electricity illegally from the station. That can constitute a fire hazard. It may be illegal under the Electricity Act as well, but more importantly, it will constitute a fire hazard because you will overload the line that is conveying power to that building. Let me repeat again. The police station building is being used to supply all the other buildings in the station compound with electricity. These other buildings are supposed to have their own circuit with their own meter, and they're supposed to be drawing their electricity directly from the pole. I am told that that is not happening. So I'm asking GPL and the police force to look into this irregularity, because not only will it jeopardize the lives of policemen and women and children, if there are children living there, but they will jeopardize the lives of other surrounding neighbors. So please, law enforcement officers can't be engaging in these conducts. Anyway, Rohan, as usual, this is where we have to say goodbye.
Yes.
This program flies out.
Yeah.
You know, it's unbelievable how quickly time flies in this program.
Well, you covered a few good topics. Yeah.
So thank you very much for being here with us.
Yeah.
And if you want to say something finally to your Guyanese brothers and sisters, especially your fellow Orbitians.
Yeah, Guyana is a great place. You know, it's got a lot of potential, a lot of talent. We just got to make sure that, you know, the right thing is being done at every corner. So urge everybody, just simply do the right thing, whatever that is. I mean, you know, I'm getting to learn here. I'm getting to learn from one of the best, a guy who I trust. And that's important to me, that trust.
Okay.
And I'm here to learn, you know.
Okay.
And as time goes by, we'll see, you know, how
things
progress. Yeah.
And I look forward. I look forward for your continued support, and I hope that you will play a more active role, both here, but more importantly, in the diaspora, where you wield some influence. Viewers, this is where I have to say goodbye. Until we meet again, please take care and enjoy the rest of the season. Once again, season greetings. And if I don't see you back, well, I will see you next week, Tuesday. So we will speak about the new year and what it holds for you. So enjoy the rest of the season. Good evening, and take care of yourselves and your family. Thank you.
Stay safe.